Hi, in this video I will demonstrate how to create LabVIEW applications using the state machine principles. First, LabVIEW is a graphical programming language, and LabVIEW has powerful features for simulation, control, vision and data acquisition applications. If you want to learn more about LabVIEW in general, you can take a look at some of my other resources regarding LabVIEW. First, here you see a basic LabVIEW application. Typically, when new programmers start to learn LabVIEW, they don't know about the state machine principles, and they tend to put everything they do inside a single while loop. And when the program is growing and they add more features, the code will be very unstructured and almost impossible to read and to structure and to improve. So that's why the state machine principle is recommended in order to create larger LabVIEW applications. So typically engineers often create simple LabVIEW VIs that eventually grow out of control because they don't have the proper structure and best practices. And the solution to this problem is organizing your code and data in a way that enables that applications are modular, readable and reusable. And using the state machine approach is a good way to make it right from the early beginning. So you should always tend to start, when you start to create a new LabVIEW application, follow the state machine principle from start. And in that way, you have a good foundation for creating large LabVIEW applications that can grow. And you can include more features without breaking the good structure of your application. So the state machine is one of the fundamental architectures LabVIEW developers frequently use to build applications. So also that in addition to make your own code, LabVIEW code easy to extend and readable, it's also easy for others to take over and read and understand your application, because the state machine principle is used by many LabVIEW developers around the world. And in LabVIEW, you can create a basic state machine using a while loop in combination with a shift register and a case structure. So here in the structure palette in LabVIEW, you find the while loop and the case structure. In addition, you can also use the event structure, which I will show in the examples later. So here you see the basic foundation for the state machine. You have a while loop here, and you have a shift register. In order to create a shift register, you just click on the border of the while loop in order to create a new shift register. And here you have the case structure with the different cases inside, so you can create many cases within the case structure, and that's typically the different states you need to create in your state machine. And inside that one of the states, you can use this event structure. So typically use the event structure to let LabVIEW handle the events from the user. So when the user click on a button, do some interaction in your user interface, you can create events that do some actions according to that. So a state machine, a while loop, a case structure, shift register, and an event structure. And that's all you need in order to create a state machine, which is used to organize and structure your code in a better way compared to an ordinary while loop alone. So always make sure that you have a good structure of your LabVIEW code from the early beginning. Use the state machine principles, which I will show you here in an example. In addition, you should use the Project Explorer, which is part of LabVIEW, and you should also create and use sub-VIs. So here you see the Project Explorer in LabVIEW. It's just those who are familiar with Visual Studio and the Solution Explorer, it's very similar. It's a way to organize The files, it could be LabVIEW files, it could be images, etc. And all these files are part of your LabVIEW project, and you have everything connected together in a structured way. You can have different folders, and you can have sub-VIs. Here you can also use the Project Explorer in order to create and build executable application of your LabVIEW application. So in addition to using the state machine principle, you should use the Project Explorer, and also in addition you should create and use sub-VIs. If you follow these three simple guidelines in your applications, they will be easy to expand, easy to bug fix, easy to maintain, and it's easy for others to take over your code because you follow the basic foundation for all LabVIEW programs. So now I will go through a basic LabVIEW example where I will use these basic principles: the state machine, the Project Explorer, and create and use sub-VIs. So here you see my main application. Here I have just a list of sensors. I can add more sensors just by clicking the new button, and then the new sensor will be added to this list. And then when I select a specific sensor, I will show the Celsius value from that specific temperature sensor here. In this example, I will just use a random generator in order to create a Celsius value for the specific temperature Celsius I click here in the list. And then when this Celsius value has been created or calculated, I will again then create a sub-VI that calculates the Fahrenheit value. And all this will be implemented using the Project Explorer and the state machine principles. And I will create a sub-VI for the calculation of creating or converting from Celsius to Fahrenheit. In addition, when you click the new button here, I will use a sub-VI that pops up in order to enter a new temperature sensor. So that's the front panel. Here you see the a part of the block diagram using the state machine principle, where I have the while loop, the case structure, the event structure, and finally this shift register that is on the border of the while loop. So that's the block diagram, and here I have the Project Explorer for this application. I have a main VI, I have some sub-VIs. You can use this build specification in order to create an executable application of your project. You can have a folder with some images and a folder for different kind of resources. So let's go to LabVIEW and start creating this application. So let's open LabVIEW, and then when this getting started window is opened, you can click on this create new project button in order to create a new project. And then you have some templates you can use, but typically I just want to use this blank project, and click finish. And then a new blank project will be created. You click on the save button in order to save it on your hard drive. I just created a folder where I want to put it, and you need to name the project file. Then this, you see these files has been created inside this folder, and now we could start creating some folders. A folder for the main VI. Could have a folder for sub-VIs, a folder for images, and a folder for other resources. It could be documents, etc. So in that way you have a good structure on your hard drive, which you should use as part of this project. So then I can right click here to add an existing folder, can add the images folder, I can add the main VI folder, the resources folder, and finally this sub-VIs folder. And then of course later you can create more folders if you want to, but that's typically the basic folders you need in your project. Then you can start creating our main VI. I just right click here, new VI, and then a new blank VI has been created. I start by saving it to the hard drive and then I put it in the main VI folder. So here we can find a proper name for our application. I just call it LabVIEW main application. You can call it whatever you like. And now let's start to create this state machine. So we start with a while loop like this. We right click on the border on the left side to create the shift register. Inside the while loop we create this case structure like this, and then you can remove the question mark here connected to this question mark, and then we start to create an initial state. Typically we need to have some initializing in the beginning. It could be to clear the user interface, open a connection to the database or to a file or whatever. So we just wire it to the shift register like this, and then we can have a state called initialize like this. So the same name here, I can, no it's not the same name, it's like this, so it's the same name. So now when we the program is start running, it will go into this initial case and do the code that is inside that that state. And next we should go to another state. We can call it the wait case, which we can create here. So this wait case could be the default case. So it's the default, and then typically you need to create more cases later, but now we have this initial case. Here you can create code that should be executed in the beginning of the application, and then we can have this wait case where inside here we create this event structure like this. In addition, you also need to wire this this condition for the while loop. So you just find a boolean constant like this, wire it in each of the different cases. Like this. It could be, should be false. So here we have this condition for the while loop. So by default, the while loop stops when this is true. So in addition to these cases, we should also have a exit case like this. And then this should be set to true like this. And also we could have create a template that we can use when we need to create more cases, then we can just copy this template like this. So now we can rearrange them so we have them in the proper order, initialize in the beginning like this, and the wait and the template and the exit case at the bottom like this. So now we have almost finished with our state machine template. So also here in this wait, we should go to a new case. Just make it a little bit bigger. It's important that your code is well structured, so it's easy to maintain, like this. This program is still not running, so in exit case we also need to have this as part of the shift register, like this. So now we have created this basic state machine. You just need to add some code here in the wait. Here is the timeout, so if there are no events, if the user is not clicking any buttons or not doing anything, we can go to this timeout case. So I set the timeout here, create a constant, and set it to 100 milliseconds. So after 100 milliseconds, this event case will go into timeout. I also can set the name here so we know which are which, like this, and for the while loop. So now we have the while loop, the case structure, and the event structure inside there. And for the timeout, we typically can just have a short timer in order to save processor time. Visible items, label, and the input here is how long we should wait in milliseconds, typically 100 milliseconds like this. So now we have created the basic structure for the state machine in our application. In addition, we should also have some error handling in our application. So we can here on the front panel create or use this error in and error out clusters that we connect to our state machine. We have the error in on the left side and the error out on the right side of the state machine. So here in the bottom is create a new shift register where we connect this error cluster like this, and then we wire it into our case structure like this and put it to the output. And then we need to do that for all the cases like this. So for initialize, wait, template case, and finally this exit case. So that's our state machine. So let's start to create our graphical user interface, the front panel. But before we start to create our user interface, we should have make a copy of this this state machine. So I make a copy of it. I put it in the sub-VI folders. I call it template, so I can use this state machine in my other VIs, like some of the sub VIs. So I have this for later, and then I can just go to my Project Explorer and drag this template in to this sub VI folder like this. But let's open the main application and start to create a user interface. I want to have this list of temperature sensors here. I have this numeric. I find can use this one for my Celsius. Showing the temperature value in Celsius, so I can name it Celsius. This list box, I can name it sensor list or something, and then I can, for instance, using this thermometer to present the value in Fahrenheit like this. I'll make it be the same size as the other one. I can also right click on this one. Visible items, digital display, and how the digital value for the temperature in addition to this this one, and the same for the other one. Visible items and digital display. Put it wherever you like. I put it in the bottom like this. Like this, and now we can have a button for adding a new sensor in the list there. So we can see if we find an add button, which you can put here. Typically, we don't want to have this text since the text is also inside the button, and we can put it here under the list. In addition, you typically want to have a exit button. Change the name from cancel to exit, and then you can change the title inside the button exit, and then you can hide this text on the top, this label. So now we are almost finished with our graphical user interface. We can hide these errors clusters because you typically don't want to see them in our user interface. So now we have our user interface ready, and now we just need to start creating code. Let's start creating the code. I can just change this to new instead, new sensor. And then when the user clicks on this button, we should create a pop-up window where the user can enter a new sensor that will be added to this list. So let's go back to our state machine. And here you see all the user interface objects we have created. I just put them here for now. And I go to the weight and this event structure. And then I right click on the event structure in order to create a new event, add event case. And then we find this new button or add button. Like this, I can change it to new. And then and change the name, also this is automatically changed. So now when the user clicks on this button, the program should go into this event and do the thing, execute the code inside here, and then I just want to redirect to a new case in my, or a new state in my state machine. So then new sensor. So now it should go to the a new state or case which is called new sensor. So then I go to my case structure, use the template as a basis, right click and select duplicate case, and then I have changed it to name new sensor. So then now how the following cases initialize, wait, and then have the template, and have the new sensor and the exit case or state. And inside here, I want to create a code that pops up this window where the user can enter a new name for a new sensor in my list. So luckily, I created a copy of my state machine and put it in the SVI folder, called the template. So now I can just copy this template and create a new sub VI called new sensor, like this. And the new sensor should be inside here, and it should be part of the state machine as well. So inside here in the sub VIs, add file and this this one, so it should be part of the project explorer as well. So it's easy to see this structure and easy to open the different files. So now let's start to create this new pop-up window, and since we have already created the state machine, we can reuse this one and just create the necessary use interface for this sub VI. So the thing we need here is a field where the user can enter a new temperature sensor. So we can call it just sensor name, like this. And so that's the name of this control, the label. But typically we just want to hide the label, and then we want to show the caption. And then we can have a space, use column, etc. to have a more readable name compared to the name of the object, like this. In addition, we want to have some buttons. Typically we want to have a OK button and a cancel button, like this. And we can show or hide the label, like this. And then you can hide these error clusters. And now we have created the user interface for this sub VI. So we hide the error cluster, make it a little bit smaller, so we just show the necessary part of the front panel, like this. And now we need to do some settings here. We right click on this symbol. We can start to create a proper icon for the sub VI. Just right click on this one to delete the existing one. We can have a border. We can have some text inside. You can call it new sensor, like this. You can change the font size, etc. Now we have created a proper icon, and then you see in our main application it's easy to find the sub VI because we have created this icon. You can right double click on it, and now we can also on this icon we can right click, select VI properties, select the Windows appearance and customize. Typically we want to have a Windows as a title. We don't want to show the menu. We don't want to have scroll bars. We don't want to show the toolbar or the abort button or the run button. We want to show the front panel when called and close it afterwards. And the user can close the window. You don't want him to resize or minimize it. Since this should be a pop-up, it should also be a model. This means that the user needs to, when this window pops up, he has to fill out the information, and then he can click either the OK button or the cancel button before this windows disappear. We don't want to have this runtime shortcut menus. Remove this one. Click OK. Then we should be finished. Execution. Then this should be okay. So now we can finish the code for this application. So when this pops up, the user will enter a sensor name, and then the name of the sensor should go back to the main VI. So you typically want to have create a hidden indicator here, which we can call sensor name output, and then we can start the wiring here. In addition, also we need to figure out if the user has clicked the OK button or the cancel button. So then we can have, in addition, create an enumerator. We can call it status, and then we can create two different states here inside here. OK, add after, or cancel. So then you have two different status, either OK or cancel. And then we can start wiring the inputs and outputs for our sub-VI. It's typically the arrow in and the arrow out. We wire them in the bottom here. And then the status could be on the top. And this output, the sensor name output, could be an output here. And then we just hide these fields like this, and then we create the rest of the code. So we have two buttons, OK and cancel, and then we go to the wait case and create two new event here, one for the OK button when the value change, and then we want to go to a new case or a status called OK, and the same for the cancel button, add event case, cancel button, value change, OK, and then you have the cancel button here, and then create a new state, create constant, cancel. Then and we have this template, we right click, duplicate case, and then we call one for OK and one for cancel, like this. And then in the cancel, we typically don't, then we use this status. So when we click the OK button, we want to have the status to be, we just right click on this one, create a constant, and then set this to OK. We make a copy of it to create a local variable, and in the cancel state or case, you want this to be cancel, like this. And in addition, when we click, the user click the OK button, he want to copy the string he enters inside here into this sensor name output, like this. So basically, that's the pop-up sub-VI for this new sensor. Then we start to create the code inside our main application. So when the user clicks on this button, this window should pop up, and the name of the sensor that the user enters should be popping up in this list, but only if he clicks on the OK button. So then we can inside here create a case structure, and then we wire the status on our sub-VI to this case structure, like this. And here you have the sensor name. And if we click cancel, we don't need to do anything, but if we click OK, we want to add it to this list. So then we right click here, create a property node, and find the right property node. We have a property node called item names, I make a copy of it and then change this one to write and this one to read. And then we find or use this build array. So that vary this one to the build array function. And then we add the new name that the user enter in the list here, like this. And the output will be the new array with this new element inside, like this. So that's the code for this one. Let's see if it works or not. Let's start the application. Click the run button. Typically here on also on our main application. We don't want to have this toolbar. So we don't want to have this toolbar. So we can go inside here as well. VI properties, select Windows appearance for our main application, customize. We want to have a title bar, we don't want to show the menu in this case, and the scroll bar should be off. Show the toolbar when running, no. Abort button, no. Show the run button. Like this, and this should be the default. We can allow the user to close the window, but not to resize. Don't want to have these shortcut menus like this. In addition, we also need to have this when we click this exit button, the program should stop. So in our event structure, we should have an event for the exit button. Like this. And then when the user click this button, we should go to the exit case, which is this one. And then since this is true, the while loop will stop and the program will stop. So let's start our test our application now. Let's run it. Okay, I need to of course have the run button here. Let's go back to customize, show the run button like this, and let's click on it, and then you see the menu bar, toolbar, everything disappear, and this one has been disabled. And let's click on the exit button, and then when I click this one, the code goes into the exit case, and this condition goes to true and the program stops. Let's see, we start one more. Let's click on new one. Yeah, this pop-up window pops up. We can enter a name here. Sensor 1, click OK. Yeah, it's not working yet. So let's see, we go into this CBI new sensor. Okay, so it initialize, it go to initialize case and then go to the wait. And then we have the timeout. It should of course not go to initialize, but to wait like this. And then we have the okay, okay, cancel, cancel. And then okay, it should go not to wait, but to exit. And the same here, when you click the case, it should go further to the exit case, and then the exit case has true here. So let's test application now. Open the main application. Click this one. Temp sensor 1. Click OK. Yeah, and it pops up in the list. You can try once more. Typically you see we have this previous name here. Typically we don't want to have the previous name, so we can go into this CVI. So in our initialize case here, we can create a local variable, and then you just want to clear the text inside the box like this. Another thing also, when this one pops up, we also want to have this in focus. So we can right click, create property node, select key focus. Right click, create property node and key focus, and then in the initial case you set this to right click, create a constant, and we set this to true like this. We close it, start our main application, and the same here. In our main application we have this sensor from the previous run. Also here in the initial case for the main application, we could also clear this list. So we just create a property node, and we have this item names property. We change it to right click, create, and a constant. This is an empty array, meaning when we start the application, this should be empty. We create a new one, temp1, temp2. Let's say we want to have temp3, but we click the cancel button, and then this one will not be added because we clicked the cancel button. And then we click the exit in order to close or exit our application. So next, when we have created some sensors here, and when we click the different sensors in the list, we want to generate a Celsius value. Of course, in real life, this could be retrieving this value from a DAC device or something, but in our simple application, we will just use the random generator in order to generate a random value for the specific sensor we click in the list here. So let's go to the block diagram. So when we click here in the list, we want to generate a Celsius value. So then we need to go to the weight and this event structure, create a new event, add event, and then for this sensor list, when the value changes, when we click in the list and select a sensor, we want to calculate or generate a Celsius value. So then we need to click and create an event for that. So then we have this sensor list, and when the value change, it should go to a new case. We just right click, create a new case called we can call it Celsius like this, and then we go here to the template, right click, duplicate, and we call it Celsius like this. And then here I want to use this random function we have in LabVIEW. I just use the search random. I can use this random number range function, click and select this one. And then you see it has a lower and an upper limit, and the output number will be generated here. And then you can also select the data type. I just want to have a temperature value, which should be a double. And then the lower bound could be 20 or something. I can also right click here, select visible items and the label in order to make the code more readable. And the same for this upper limit, right click, create constant, and right click visible items label, and it could be 50 or something, or let's make it from 10 to 30. And then this output should be connected to this one, the Celsius, this one. We make this right click, make it an indicator, an output here. We wire it to this Celsius object like this. So now let's see what's happening when we run the code. We start to make some sensors. Sensor 1. Sensor 2. Sensor 3, like this, and when we click here, it will generate. We also should change the scale here from 10 to 30, like this. And then you see, when we click the different sensors, it will generate a new Celsius value, like this. So we can also change the number of decimals here. We don't typically don't want to have 4 decimals. So we can right click on this one, display format, select digits of precision. We typically just need 1 digits like this. And you can do the same for the Fahrenheit. Like this. And now we are almost finished. We have this list. And when you click here, we have this pop-up, and then we create a new sensor in the list. When we click on one of the sensors, we generate a Celsius value. And finally, we also want to convert the Celsius value to Fahrenheit. So let's create this final case. I just use the template, duplicate it, and call it Fahrenheit, like this. I want to rearrange them to make them in a properly order. So then the new sensor comes first, then we have the Celsius and the Fahrenheit, and I exit like this. And then inside here, I want to create a sub VI that convert the Celsius value to Fahrenheit. So then let's go back to our Project Explorer. We want to create a new sub VI. Now we are going to create just a basic sub VI, so you don't need to use this state machine template. So you just right click, create new VI, and then we create one input, which is the Celsius value, and one output, which is the Fahrenheit value, like this. Make them like this, and then we use this icon, select this on here on the inputs and output. We select patterns. Since there is only one input and one output, we can select this one, and then this should be the input and this should be the output for this sub VI. We should also create a proper icon. I just double click on this one in order to delete the existing one. Create a simple border and make some Celsius to Fahrenheit or something. Click OK. And then start creating the code. The formula for this is like this. So we have the temperature in Celsius, and the output should be in Fahrenheit. Then typically we need to multiply the temperature by this factor, and we have to add 32 like this. So this is the basic formula for converting from Celsius to Fahrenheit. So let's implement this formula in LabVIEW code. 9 divided by 5. So we have here in numeric this divide. We right click on top, create a constant 9 divided by 5, and then you have to multiply with this value, numeric multiply like this, and then this we need to add 32, so we find this add. Like this, right click, create constant 32. So basically that's the formula for converting from Celsius to Fahrenheit created in LabVIEW. So that's the sub VI. We change the name, we save a name for it. You can just call it convert to Fahrenheit like this, put it in the sub VI folder, and then just make sure that this sub VI is inside this main Fahrenheit case. We can just drag it in like this. So now we want to convert the Celsius to Fahrenheit, so we need this one. We just create a local variable which we use as an input here, and the output should be this one which we find here. So that's the sub VI for converting from Celsius to Fahrenheit. So when we have generated the Celsius value we want to convert, so then we can go to this next state directly like this. So I also just copied in order to make it correct. So now we go to this Fahrenheit, and then when this calculation has been done it goes back to this wait case in order to wait for a new action from the user clicking a button or whatever. So let's save and run this application. We add some sensors, clicking OK. Like this, and then we can click here in list, and you see the Celsius is generated, and automatically it generates the proper Fahrenheit value for that specific value. So basically that's a simple application where we have used a state machine principle in order to create a well-structured block diagram which is easily extendable, and it's easy to maintain, and it's easy to find the bugs etc. inside your application. So we also have created this pop-up window. We have created a sub VI for the conversion between Celsius and Fahrenheit, and we have this exit button in order to stop the application. So let's just go through the different cases. We start with the initialize. We have some initialize code here. We just want to empty this one when we start application, and then we go to the wait case, and then we just wait for the user to either click the new button, the exit button, or to change some of to click in this sensor list. And if you click the new button it goes to the new sensor case. This window pops up and a new sensor is added to the list if the user clicks the OK button, and then it goes back to the wait case and waiting for a new action from the user. And then if he clicks either want to create a new sensor, it goes back to the new sensor case, and if he clicks on the sensor list he generates a proper Celsius value, and then automatically calculate the Fahrenheit value using this sub VI. So that's a basic LabVIEW application using this state machine. So now you have learned how to create a proper LaBio application using this state machine principle. By using the state machine, creating and using sub-VIs and using the property Project Explorer, it's easy to create large and advanced LaBio applications, and it's easy to add more features. It's easy to maintain. It's easy to read the code for you and for others, and it's easy to find bugs. So this is the way you should create your LaBio applications. So good luck. Thank you.